In Jesus' name we pray. And the headquarters church says, amen. Heavenly Father, we do thank you tonight. It's always a joy and we're always excited to be together. What a fellowship we have and what blessings we have when we gather together, having the same heart and the same mind, the same goal, and we want to receive from you. Tonight, we come together once again. And Lord, we pray that your Spirit will teach us tonight very clearly, convincingly, in Jesus' name. And the desire to do, and the desire to observe, the desire to practice exactly what you are telling us and teaching us from on high, you grant unto us in Jesus' name. Lord, tonight I say, let the weak say, I am strong. Let the sick say, I am well. Let those who are shy, those who are timid, let them say, I am bold in the Lord. Oh Lord, I pray that courage, conviction, and boldness will come to everyone in Jesus' name. As the people of the world announce what they have, and they stand up in the bus, and they talk in the taxi, and they speak in the market, and speak everywhere, and they speak over the radio, over the television, and also publicize the little things they have in the papers, we have the greatest thing on earth. We have something that will take man from earth to heaven. Lord, we pray that the boldness, the zeal, the excitement, the courage, the excitement, and the power to declare what we have and to invite people to this coming December retreat, you give to everyone in Jesus' name. Give our children the boldness and the courage. Our brothers and sisters, the boldness and the courage. Our students on campuses, the boldness, the courage. Our children and students in secondary school, the boldness and the courage. Our workers and pastors, the boldness and the courage. Our members and everybody that hears, the boldness and the courage. So that, Lord, will publicize the thing. We'll blaze it abroad. We'll tell everyone. And Lord, every retreat location will be full to overflowing. And from that first night, Lord, we just pray showers of blessing. Showers of blessing. As people are stepping on that retreat ground, even before we pray over there, healing will be taking place. Miracles will be taking place. Supernatural abundance will flow into our lives in Jesus' name. Over there, Lord, we pray the sinners will be saved. Believers will be sanctified. The power of God from on high will come upon everybody in Jesus' name. And Lord, as we go and publicize every need of our lives, you meet those needs. There will be no lack in our midst again. There will be no limitation in our lives again. We pray that heaven will fill our soul, our mind, our heart, our families, our church, in Jesus' name. Tonight, you have promised to speak to us. Lord, speak, for thy children are hearing. And let what we hear energize, empower, equip every one of us. Thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You can sit down. We have a special, special study. Everybody say special study. And we're talking about the December retreat. And we're teaching from scriptures concerning this December retreat. I told you already during the time of prayer that the December retreat will be from the 24th of December until the 27th of December, just this month. Something is coming your way. It's going to be great. This December retreat is yours and it's mine. And thank God I will be there. My family will be there. Anyone I know, anyone I can touch, I'm going to influence. Anyone I can influence, they will be there and you will be there. And God is going to do great, great, marvelous things in our lives in Jesus' name. What are we talking about today? We're talking about preparation for a great harvest of blessings. Preparation for a great harvest of blessings. We always have to prepare. When God says, I want to do this, and I want to shower my blessings upon my people, the people of God, they have to be ready. And we have to prepare preparation for a great harvest of blessing. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40, we're looking at verse 3. The voice of him that cries in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted. Already you can see what the prophet is saying. The prophet knew that a new thing was coming. Actually, as you look at Isaiah, Isaiah was a special prophet. And you see, this is Isaiah chapter 40. Before chapter 40, you have chapter, tell me out loud, 39. Chapter 1 to chapter 39 is like the old covenant. It's like the old testament. And it's like the old thing that had happened to the children of Israel. When you come to chapter 40, that's the beginning of the new thing the Lord wants to do. As you come to this December retreat, it's the end of a year that opens up the beginning of another year. And it says you should prepare because the new year will be different. The sorrows of the past year, everything will go. And the heartaches and the sickness of the past years, everything will vanish away. And then as you open the new page, chapter 40, then the prophet tells us, he says, this is going to be a new era, a new dispensation. And he says, we have to prepare the way of the Lord. And then he tells us, after we have that preparation, look at what will happen. Number one, every valley shall be exalted. Valley is what is down there, down below. And it says, it will be exalted. If you have been in the valley, you are going to have exaltation. Number two, every mountain and hill shall be made low. That is, when you come to this new era, new dispensation, new period, a new time, it says the mountains and the hills that hindered you because they were high and you couldn't climb over them, they will be made low. And then number three, the crooked shall be made straight. Anything crooked in your life, in your business, in your family, in your work, everything will be straightened out. Then number four, and the rough places, it says, shall be made plain. Thank God when we finish and we get through that retreat, everything that has been rough and every life has been rough and tough. But thank God, retreat time is coming. I said retreat time is coming. And all those rough places shall be made plain. And then number five, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. It will be revealed in your life. And then it says, and all flesh shall see together. Number seven, all flesh shall see together. And for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. If I were you, I'll start preparing because something great is going to happen. Actually, as we talk about the gathering together of the people of God, from time immemorial, that is, from the time of old, God has desired that his own people will gather together so he can bless them. Let me tell you a secret. There are some things you'll never get in isolation. There are some blessings you'll never receive all alone by yourself. I don't care how studious you are, how spiritual you are, how serious you are. If you stay alone all by yourself, there are some things you'll never taste, you'll never know. But it's when you gather together with the people of God, and you gather together with the people who pray, and the people who love the Lord, you gather together with them, a lot of things that you couldn't get by yourself, those things will begin to happen to you. Let me show you in Genesis chapter 49. Genesis chapter 49, verse 10. Genesis 49, verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet. until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. You see that? That is prophecy. You know, this December retreat is a fulfillment of prophecy. Because it says, unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Anybody that stays behind, anybody that will not gather together with the people of God, when the overflowing blessings of God are coming from heaven, he doesn't want to be a part of the fulfillment of this great prophecy. I'm going to be a part of that fulfillment. Unto him shall the gathering of the people be. It's not only a prophecy, it's a commandment. Look at Psalm 50. I'm looking at Psalm 50, and we're looking at verse 5. Psalm 50, verse 5. In Psalm 50, verse 5, it says, gather my saints together unto me. Gather my saints together unto me. That's a commandment. It was a prophecy. Unto him shall the gathering of the people be. And then God said, for that to happen, you, the minister, you, the child of God, you, the overseer, you, the pastor, and you, the workers, he gives you the commandment, and you, the member of the body of Christ, he gives us the commandment, gather my people together unto me. It says, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. You know what that means? What that means is this. There are people who have given their lives to the Lord. They have made a covenant with the Lord by sacrifice. They have paid the price of consecration. And then they are expecting the blessings of consecration to come upon them. And God says, I'm not going to give you the blessing in isolation. When you're all alone by yourself, a lot of things you have been praying for and desiring. It is when we gather together. That's when God will pour out all those blessings. That's why he said, gather my saints together unto me. Those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. And then in Zephaniah chapter 3, Zephaniah, that's getting to almost the end of the Old Testament, Zephaniah chapter 3, we're looking at verse 19. Behold, at that time, I will undo all that afflict thee. Give me a good amen. And I will save her that halteth, and gather her that was driven out. I will gather her that was driven out. You see what the Lord is now saying? Number one, I told you a prophecy. Number two, a commandment. Number three, now, this is a promise. I will gather him that was driven out. How many people have been driven out of their places of work? How many people have been driven out of the places where they live? How many houses or buildings have been demolished and they want to drive them out of their community? How many people have been driven out of the joy and the happiness and the goodness of the Lord? And the Lord is saying, when you gather together, when you fulfill the prophecy, and when you obey the commandment to gather my saints together, and then myself, I will gather her that was driven out, I will get them praise and fame in every land. In every land. That means the retreat location is not just one location. There's going to be a retreat location at the headquarters here, and then in all the various regions, and then in all the various states, and then in all the various nations in Africa, as well as beyond Africa. And the Lord already said that in every land where they have been put to shame, he said, he'll wipe our shame away. As we gather together, then he says, all the shame we had before, everything will vanish away. At that time, I will bring you again. Even in the time that I gather you. It says when you respond to this gathering, the great gathering that is going to happen, it's not just you alone, you are in partnership with the Almighty God. And he says, I will gather you. And then he says, I will make you a name. They will not blot out your name. You'll not get out of the register. He says, I'll make you a name, and he prays among all people of the earth. When I turn back your captivity before your eyes, says the Lord. Thank God that is going to happen. Isaiah chapter 56, I'm reading from verse 7. Isaiah chapter 56, and we're looking at verse 7 and then verse 8. the gathering of the people as we gather together unto the Lord. Isaiah 56 verse 7, even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. And when we get to that retreat, if you didn't know to pray, the spirit of prayer and supplication will come upon you. And then it says, when we pray like that, he will give us the fullness of joy. I'll make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and the sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar. For mine house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. The Lord God, which gathereth the outcasts of Israel, says, the Lord God, which gathereth. You see that word gather, gathering, gathereth all over the Bible. It means then, if you're a Bible believer, if you're a true child of God, if you have a Bible in your hand and you obey that Bible, you're going to gather together with the people of God. It says, the Lord God, which gathereth the outcasts of Israel, saith, yet will I gather others to him. Will I gather others to him? What does that mean? It's saying there are those who are others. They are not here now. They are not part of the church now. All the members of the church, the saints of God, we're going to gather together. And then the others, those who have not known the Lord, those who have not come here before, those who are not part of us, he said, and I will, yet will I gather others to him besides those that are gathered unto him. Ourselves, our neighbors, our friends, our co-workers, the Lord says they will gather with us. And while the Lord is blessing us, the Lord will bless them as well. And when we gather together like that, it is a sign, number one, that we're willing to fulfill the prophecy. Number two, that we're willing to yield and obey the commandment of the Lord. Number three, that we want to be in partnership with God so that he can fulfill his promise. Number four, it means that there is a commission with promise. The Lord says, do it. That's the commission. And then he attaches a promise to it and will say, yes, Lord, we're looking for the fulfillment of the promise and therefore we're going to obey the commission. And it's a proof of our gratitude that God can even talk to us and he says, I want to bless you and what I want to give you, I cannot give you in isolation. Where you are in your house, you must gather together. And when we gather like that, it's a proof of our gratitude to God and a confirmation of our faith in the Lord. That what we didn't have before, God says, we're going to have it this December. And because we believe that, it's a confirmation of our faith, and therefore we go to gather with the people of God. We're going to deal with this study under three subtitles. Number one, personal preparation for the promised blessings. Personal preparation for the promised blessing. Number two, proclamation by people desiring the promised blessings. Proclamation by the people desiring the promised blessings. Number three, participation and prayer for the promised blessings. Let's come to number one. We're talking about personal preparation for the promised blessings. What kind of preparation does the Lord want me to make as a pastor? What kind of preparation does the Lord want you to make as our overseer in our state, our overseer in our region, our pastor in our local church? What kind of preparation does God want you to make as a member of the choir? A preparation the Lord wants you to make as a student, as a campus student, as a secondary school student, a kind of preparation the Lord is calling upon you to make as a woman coordinator, and then as a coordinator, the pastor of a local church in that district. What kind of preparation the Lord is asking us to make as members of the church? And as for those who are here today, you are here for the first time, you are part of this too. What kind of preparation is the Lord desiring from you and from me, from every one of us? Isaiah chapter 62. Isaiah chapter 62. I'm reading from verse 10 and verse 11. Go through the gates, Prepare ye the way of the people. Prepare ye the way of the people. Now something great is happening, and a lot of people are going to be coming from every direction. And the Lord is saying, we need to prepare the way for those people to come. Cast up the highway. Gather out the stones. Lift up a standard for the people. It's talking about preparing for the people to come. It's not just that you are prepared only to come. You are going to come. I said you are going to come. But now, you need to prepare the way for the people to come. And it says to take all hindrances away. Anything that will be a stumbling block between you and your neighbor, that if you talk to him, he will not accept to take that away. Anything that will be a hindrance between you and your co-workers in the office, between you and the people in the market, between you and a fellow student, between you and anybody, your relative, you take all the hindrances away, you cast out the stones, and then you're able to prepare the people and prepare the way for them to come. In verse 11, it says, behold, the Lord has proclaimed unto the end of the world, say ye to the daughter of Zion, behold, thy salvation cometh. It says, everybody you meet, daughters of Zion, the men and the women, you will tell everyone. Now, it's when it says daughter of Zion, I'm sure there are some people that are thinking that means only women. You have to read your Bible very well to understand the Bible. Sometimes when it says the bride of Christ, the wife of the Lamb, it's not just talking about the men, the women, it's talking about the whole church, the whole people that belong to the Lord, young and old and men and women. The same thing, there are times the daughter of Zion is used as a kind of title for all the people of God in Israel. And the Lord is saying, behold, thy salvation cometh. During this retreat, thy salvation cometh. Thy deliverance cometh. And the joy of the Lord will be your strength in Jesus' name. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. And when he talks about clearing the obstacle, taking the difficulties away, and telling everybody that you meet, everybody that you see, that something great is happening, and the salvation of the Lord, the fullness of the freedom that you need in the Lord, everything is coming. Get ready and take the hindrances away. Let me show you examples in Genesis chapter 45. Genesis chapter 45. And I'm reading there from verse 25. And the story here is that there had been a famine all over. A famine in the land. And Jacob was an old man by this time. And all his sons and their families, they were going through that famine. And then surplus, abundance was somewhere, and they discovered it. And now they had to come back to tell Jacob about that abundance. It was the preparation. But you see, Jacob had some sorrow in his heart because he didn't know what had happened to Joseph. And now they had to take all the obstacles away and show evidence to Jacob that something good was happening in Egypt, and they needed to go there. Genesis chapter 45, verse 25. And they went up out of Egypt and came into the land of Canaan unto Jacob their father. And he told him, saying, Joseph is yet alive. He is governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart fainted, for he believed them not. You see, some things that happened. He thought Jacob had died. And therefore, when they said Jacob is still alive, and there is blessing waiting for them over there, he didn't believe. His heart fainted. And that's the reason why you need to take the stones away, take the obstacles away, show them an evidence that this December retreat we're inviting them to is going to be a great time, a great gathering, and of abundance is coming upon everyone. How did they take the hindrances away? How did they gather the stones out of the way so that Jacob will be able to go? Look at it now in verse 27. And he told him all the words of Joseph, which he had said unto them. And when he saw the wagons which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived. And Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, is yet alive. I will go. Those are the words we're looking for. Those are the words we want to get from the people we're inviting. When you tell them for the first time, maybe they are shaking. Maybe they are doubting. And then you begin to give them evidence. This is going to happen. This is going to happen. This is going to happen. And you tell them with confidence. And the Lord will back up your confidence. Every good thing you tell them will happen at that retreat. Every good thing will happen to them. And then you talk to them convincingly until, like Jacob, they will be able to say, I will go. Look at the next chapter, chapter 46, from verse 2. And God spake unto Israel in the visions of the night, and said, Jacob, Jacob. And he said, here am I. And he said, I am God, the God of thy father. Fear not to go down into Egypt, for I will there make of thee a great nation. I will go down with thee. Look at that. You see, when you tell the people, tell them to pray also about it. And then the Lord will convince them. And the Lord told Jacob, he said, that's a good decision you have made. You said you will go. I too, the Almighty God, I will go with you. As you are sitting down there, you are making up your mind, I will go, I will go, I will go. Almighty God is reassuring you, I will go there with you. It's there I will meet all your needs. It's there I will bless you. It's there I will pour all my blessings upon you. And let me read from Numbers chapter 10. Numbers chapter 10. What if you tell somebody and the person says, no, I don't want to go. I have other plans. And I don't think I want to go to any retreat in such a place at this time. What will you do? Will you just give up and say, well, I told him and he said no. I told him and he said he couldn't go. What else will you do? Let's look at Numbers chapter 10. And I'm reading from verse 29. It says, Moses said unto Hobab, the son of Reguel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law. Who was this Hobab? What was he to Moses? Father-in-law. Hold on to that. We're journeying unto the place of which the Lord said, I will give it you. Come thou with us, and we will do thee good. For the Lord has spoken good concerning Israel. To start with, you can see the invitation of Moses. It was positive. It was practical. It was prophetic. He said, come thou with us. There was no doubt in the mind of Moses at all. They were going to a land flowing with milk and honey. And he told the father-in-law, he said, you must come. I've discovered something good. I see this thing. This will enrich your life. I cannot see something like this and hide it from you. Come thou with us and we will do thee good. Practical, positive, and also prophetic. When we get over there, you're going to be part of those that will have those things, the riches of the land, and we're going to have the riches of Christ. But how did the man respond? Look at it in verse 30. And he said unto him, I will not go. I will not go, but I will depart to my own land and to my kindred. You know, that's where most of us stop. When I told him, and he said, I will not go, I've done my part. If he doesn't follow us, if he doesn't have the blessing, that's not my fault. I told him, well, if you stop there, you will not know what happened later. What happened later? You see now verse 30. And he said unto him, I will not go, but I will depart to my own land and to my kindred. Let me show you what happened later. Judges chapter 1. In Judges chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 16. Judges chapter 1, verse 16. Don't leave them alone. Moses did not leave the father-in-law alone just because he told him the first time. And then the man said, no, I will not go with you. I will go back to my own land. He kept on, he kept on, he kept on, putting pressure on him. You must come, you must come. You're missing something great if you don't come. And eventually the man yielded and went with them. Judges chapter 1, verse 16. And the children of the Canaanite, Moses, what? Moses' father-in-law went up out of the city of palm trees with the children of Judah into the wilderness of Judah, which lies in the south of Arad. And they went and dwelt among the people. You see, Moses did not give up. When he told him the first time, the man said, no, I have my own plans. I have my own place. I will not go with you. I will depart back to my land. And Moses kept on telling him, between this time and the 24th of December, when we're going to start the retreat, keep on telling them, they will come. And then when they pitch their camp with us, and the Lord showers blessings upon them, they will look at you and say, thank you very much, you didn't leave me alone. If you had let me alone that first time you told me, and I said, no, I'm not going, I have my own plans during this Christmas time. If you had let me alone, look at what I've got, look at what I've got, look at what I've got. And he'll thank you. And then not only that, he'll thank you, Almighty God will bless you because of them. Moses' father-in-law still went because Moses did not give up. You will not give up. Tell everyone around you, you will tell them. Won't you tell them? You will tell them. In Luke chapter 14, we're looking at verse 23. Luke chapter 14, verse 23. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and edges and compel them to come in. That's what Moses did to the father-in-law. He compelled him. He didn't accept no for an answer. When you tell somebody and he says, no, I have my own church. No, we have our own camp. No, we have our own retreat. No, we have our own plans, and we're going to do something. You should compel them with love, with gentleness, with promises, with prayer. Compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. The Lord is telling us then, don't give up. You will not give up. In Zechariah chapter 8, now, you see, sometimes there are some people that will take part in the publicity. And then they will say, let us go, let us go, let us go. And they themselves, they're not there. When the retreat comes, you see, that kind of publicity will not be effective. If you want to be effective, while you are telling them, let us go, you yourself will say, I will go also. Those words are important. Let us go, let us go, let us go. You're inviting them. And you too, you are saying, I will go also. We're looking at Zechariah chapter 8. Look at this, verse 21. Zechariah chapter 8, verse 21. And the inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us go speedily. Let us go speedily. So far, so good. But then you have to commit yourself as well. That, yes, I'm inviting you. Will you be there yourself? Of course I'll be there. I'll be the number one there. And I'm inviting you to go. I'm not just sending you there. I'll be going along. Look at that verse 21. To pray before the Lord and to seek the Lord of hosts. Tell me the last words there. Tell me out loud. Tell me with conviction. I will go also. You see, that is the secret of effective publicity. That you know you are going. And you have made up your mind you are going. And you have prepared yourself fully that you will be there. And then with that personal commitment and personal preparation that you're going to be there, you're also telling other people, I'll be there, let's go along. I'll be there, let's go along. I'll be there, let's go along. I will go also. Look at verse 22. Yea, many people and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem and to pray before the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you make up your mind, yes, I'm going to go, and I'm inviting other people, and we're joining together, gathering together, so that we can be there. In those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold out of all the languages of the nations, even shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, we will go with you. When they see your commitment, and when they see the communication, the way you communicate it to them, when they see your confidence and your courage, and when they see your expectation and your faith, and you see that really what you're talking about is so important, that you are going, then it says, and other people will tell you, even before you talk to them, I've heard of it, we will go with you. And it says 10 people. Can you have a goal like that? You know, our leaders have given us a goal that we should make sure that each of us will get 2 people. And some people think that is hard and that is tough. And God said, I'll make you to do that which is hard. I'll make you to do that which is tough. That not even 2 alone, 10 people will come. You'll be registering their name, so-and-so, of this address, so-and-so, of this telephone number, so-and-so, of that email address. They say they will go, and you're checking up on them, you're praying with them, and they're going to go with us in Jesus' name. We will go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. This retreat that is coming, that we are prophesying already, affords people varied needs of opportunity to plunge into God's power. Because God himself, he said he has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. He's given us salvation and total freedom. We're going to have deliverance and healing. We're going to have holiness and heavenly virtues and riches. You are going to have breakthrough in every challenge in your life. Give me a good amen. Amen. And the power of the Holy Ghost will come upon your life. There will be fruitfulness in your family. Barrenness will vanish away. I said barrenness will vanish away. Have you noticed something, that the people that had children, they got the children when at the retreat? You remember Anna? Anna did not get the child at home. She could have said, I can pray at home, I can cry at home, I can express my sorrow to the Lord. But no, there was a retreat in Shiloh. And therefore she went to Shiloh, the location of that retreat. And then when all the other people were eating, she couldn't eat. And she began to pray and to pray and to pray because of the burden, the bitterness, the sorrow in her heart. And Eli said, take your wine away from you. And she said, my Lord, I've not drunk any wine. But at this retreat, I have just one request, that God will give me just one child. And then the man of God, Eli, said, be it unto you according to your desire. And then all her tears were gone. During this retreat, all your tears will go away. And then she went back home. And the moment she got home, then she got pregnant. And what was the fruit of that retreat? The fruit? Samuel. And Samuel was not just an ordinary child, became a prophet, a great prophet in the land. What God gives you in this coming retreat will not be an ordinary blessing. It will be extraordinary. That's why we're going there. The people that have got something great from the Lord, it was at the retreat when they gathered with the other people of God. That's when God gave them what they were desiring. Your own time has come. And you know, it's just December, it's only once in the year, and this is just the time, and you're going to be there. I'm going to point number 2, proclamation by people desiring the promised blessing. Proclamation by the people desiring the great blessings of the Lord. Anybody desiring the blessing of the Lord here? Oh, you are there? You are going to proclaim it then. Because if we desire the blessing, then we will proclaim this that is coming. Look at Psalm 68. Psalm 68. I'm reading from verse 11. Psalm 68, verse 11. The Lord gave the word. Great was the company of those that did what? Published it. You know the secret, if you're going to have the great blessing of the Lord, the secret is this. The people of Israel did not leave the publicity only in the hands of Moses. Oh, he's a full-time pastor. He's a full-time shepherd. He's a full-time leader. Let him do all the publicity. The Lord gave the word, and great was the company of the people that published it. The people did not give it. I'm not a prophet. I'm not a shepherd. I'm not a worker. I'm not this. I'm not that. I'm not old enough. Every one of them, the moment they heard that God said, I'm ready to do something great. I'm ready to do something wonderful. And when the Lord gave the word, it says, great was the company of the people that published it. That means everyone that hears must tell other people, come. It's your responsibility, it's my responsibility, it's our responsibility together. Everyone will tell the story. Everyone will call the people. Everyone will gather the people. And as we gather them, they will come. And then God will bless them and God will bless us. Psalm 145. Psalm 145. I'm reading from verse 9. Psalm 145, verse 9. The Lord is good to all. Is that right? And his tender mercies are over all his works. All thy works shall praise thee. O Lord, thy saints shall bless thee. They shall speak of the glory of thy kingdom and talk of thy power. They shall speak and they shall talk. That means then, we don't have any other thing to talk about this period now. Don't talk about rain, about weather, about sunshine, about economy, about politics, about this. There's only one thing to talk about at this time. You're phoning somebody, there's only one thing to talk about. And you're sending email to somebody, there's only one thing to talk about. You're sending a text message on their telephone, there's only one thing to talk about. You're writing a letter, there's only one thing to talk about. You're making an announcement, there's only one thing to talk about. From now until that retreat time, just talk about it. You're a child of God, and you have heard that God is going to do something great, something wonderful. This is what to talk about between husband and wife. This is what to talk about between parents and children. This is what to talk about between teachers and students. This is what to talk about between neighbors and co-tenants. This is what to talk about. Everybody talking about it, so that everywhere the noise is being blazed abroad that this retreat is coming. And when you go here, if you meet brother A, that's what he's talking about. If you go to meet sister D, that's what she's talking about. Anywhere you go, this is what we're all hearing. That's when everybody will brace up and say, this is something I have to be there. And they'll be there. I said he'll be there. And you'll be glad it was because you spoke about it. That's why they were there. And when God is blessed, they will never forget you. They'll never forget you. And they'll say, brother so-and-so got me to that place and see what God has done for me. As they're praying for themselves, they'll be praying for you too. And then he tells us in verse 11, let me read again. They shall speak of the glory of thy kingdom and talk of thy power to make known to the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Well, when something good has happened, if you are a grateful person, if you're a person that is thankful, you're going to talk about it. Look at Daniel chapter 4. Daniel chapter 4. When something good happened to Nebuchadnezzar, he spoke about it. He wrote about it. He publicized it. He proclaimed it everywhere. And that's the same thing we should do. I'm not going to allow Nebuchadnezzar to be more righteous than I am, more grateful than I am. I'm not going to allow Nebuchadnezzar to be wiser than I am. I'm not going to allow that Old Testament monarch to be greater in the publicity and proclamation, more than I can do today, more than you can do today. You will even surpass Nebuchadnezzar. I said you surpass Nebuchadnezzar. He didn't have a radio to use. He didn't have television to use. He didn't have telephone to use. He didn't know how to send any text message. In his own time, there was no internet. And now today, we have all those gadgets and all those technological things. And now we can use quite a lot. And we can send the messages Young people, use telephone a lot. Send that message out. Retreat is coming. Tell them the time. Tell them the location, your own location. They will be there. What a great gathering we're going to have. In Daniel chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 1. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, unto all people, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. See, he wasn't even curtailing. He wasn't limiting. He wasn't moderating his publicity. You know, there are some people, they will say, take care, take care. Don't talk about it too much. If the people, if the crowd comes, how about this, how about this, how about the food they will eat, how about this, how about this. I'm telling you, God is going to surprise you. This retreat is different. I said, this retreat is different. If you have been wondering, when I get there, where will I stay? God will surprise you. What will I eat? God will surprise you. Tell them to come, and then you will see that God, this God, with God, all things are possible. And then he tells us in verse 2, I thought it good to show the signs and the wonders that the high God has wrought toward me. How great are his signs and how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion from generation to generation. He publicized that to all people, all nations, all languages that dwell in all the face of the earth. If Nebuchadnezzar could do that with his limited resources and the limited technology at that time, how much more can we do that now with all the technology that we have? Let your brain start working. Let your mind start thinking. And let your heart start seeing the vision of what you can do. How you can do it to make it reach out to many, many people. And whatever is being done already, do more of that. And whatever comes to your mind again that we have not started, start doing that so that many, many people will come. Micah chapter 4. Micah, we're looking at chapter 4. In Micah chapter 4, we're looking at verse 2. Micah chapter 4, reading from verse 2. And many nations shall come. Many nations shall come. You know that this coming retreat, many tribes will be there. Your tribe, my tribe, their tribe, our tribe, all the tribes, they will be there. In all those locations, people who have never stepped into a retreat location before, they'll be there. People who have never heard that something great, something wonderful is going on in our retreat location before, they will hear this time, they'll be there. Our relatives who have vowed they will never, never, never come to a church like this, those people, their vows will be canceled, they will come. The great will come. The small will come. The men will come. The women will come. Our well-wishers will come. Even the people, antagonistic people, they will come. And then as we gather together, there'll be an abundance of showers of blessing from on high on everybody in Jesus' name. And many nations shall come and shall say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, and to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us his ways. When we get there, he'll teach us his way. His way of salvation. His way of healing. His way of happiness. His way of holiness. His way of victory. His way of breakthrough. His way of riches. His way of prosperity. He will teach us his way of eternal life. And it's going to give us, it's going to open our eyes like this. And if you have been praying for something, and it's so hard, so tough to get that thing, you say, this is the way to get it. I didn't know it was that simple. And then you just stretch out your hand like this, because he has taught us his way. You'll get it in Jesus' name. He will teach us his way, and we will walk in his paths, for the Lord shall go forth of Zion, and the word of God from Jerusalem. Nahum chapter 1. Nahum chapter 1. We're looking at verse 15. Nahum chapter 1, verse 15. You see all these people, all these prophets of God, how they were talking about it. And he was saying, it must be done. The publicity must be carried out. And every one of the children of God must get involved in this. He tells us that you must get involved. This follows Micah, Nahum chapter 1. We're looking at verse 15. Behold, upon the mountains, like the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace. That means you're one of them, part of us, and your feet is upon the mountains. You're not just staying in the house, you're going out. As we develop all these teams, we call it, you know, it's going to be a great, great strategy that we have all these teams together, brothers apart and sisters apart. And then we have a committed, zealous, excited leader. And then we're going on every mountain, on every hill, on every community, and in every society. And we're telling them, and we're knocking on their doors, and we're phoning them, and we're contacting them. It says, behold, upon the mountains the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace. O Judah, keep thy solemn feast, perform thy vows, for the wicked shall no more pass through thee. The wicked shall no more pass through thee. While you are going and while you are doing this for the Lord will take care of everything that concerns you. That the wicked, the oppressor, the persecutor, and the destroyers, he'll shut up their mouth and cancel, neutralize their power in Jesus' name. He is utterly cut off. And thank God that we are part of this. And because we're part of this, the Lord himself is going to make sure that you are blessed and well blessed together in Jesus' name. Luke chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 38. Luke chapter 8. And we're reading from verse 38. Luke chapter 8, verse 38. Now the man out of whom the devils were departed besought him that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, you see, sometimes when we have got the blessings of the Lord, we want to just stay with the Lord, just stay in the church, just abide here. It's like Peter, let us build here 3 tabernacles, one for Moses and one for Elijah and one for you. We just want to stay here, but we're not staying here, we're going out. And we're going to tell the people. And as we tell the people, then we come together. And the very first night, and then you see all those people. And before we even open our mouth, before we begin to pray, shout of joy, shout of hallelujah, shout of miracle, and shout of breakthrough. God is going to be doing something great in that place in Jesus' name. But you see, it means that there is commitment with us. And we're not just staying here to learn, but we're going out there to declare, to proclaim, and to publicize. And it says in verse 13, and return to thine own house and show how great things God has done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city. He published how? Tell me out loud. Thank you. Not just in one corner. You know, there are some people, maybe they barely come out, and then they tell the carpenter near their door, and they say, we're having a retreat. Here is the handbill. And they say, I've done publicity. No, it goes beyond that. They go to the mechanic while they're repairing their car. Have you heard about our retreat? No, I've not heard. Here is the handbill. That's good, that's good. But that's not enough. That throughout the city, everywhere, you'll make plans for this. You'll make time for this. And you'll say, I'm going out at this time with my team. I'm going out at this time with my people. And then we're telling them, we're singing, we're rejoicing, we're excited. And people that see us, they know that something good is on the way. And then we publicize and declare unto them. And then we tell them how they're going to be at the location, because they may not know the way to that location, but we'll help them to see how they get there eventually. He published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. And it came to pass that when Jesus returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And that's going to be our experience. God expects us to herald this coming retreat with zeal and with commitment. That means then we do it in the general public. We do it in the schools. We do it on our campuses. We do it in all our communities. And we tell them that this great sin is taking place. Every means and every method must therefore be employed so that everyone will be there as we publish and publicize and we proclaim it and blaze it abroad. And then we're going to involve every member in this aggressive, productive publicity. Everyone. And you are going to be part of this. I said you'll be part of this. This is not the time to say, I'm a coordinator and I'm busy counseling. Yes, counseling is good. Come out and join us. This is not the time to say, I am a mother, a nursing mother. I don't have chance for this. No, you have chance for this. Come out and join us. I have this duty. All those duties, God will bless them and bless you in Jesus' name. But you are part of this, I'm part of this, we're all part of this, and we're going to do it together in Jesus' name. Efforts of these publicity units will be aided, number one, by specially designed publicity garments. If you have not got one yet in your region, in your state, in your nation, here in Lagos, you know, we've been going about with all the publicity garments. And so, if you have not started wearing yours, don't be ashamed, wear it, and everybody will know. And then they'll be able to ask a question, what is this all about? This colorful yellow, red, blue, whatever color it is that you are wearing. Then you'll be able to tell them, it is because of this retreat that is coming. And they'll get excited. Maybe they will even want to wear the garment as well with you. Wouldn't that be wonderful? And then if they don't have money, you'll buy it for them. It's not too costly, you can buy it for them. Not only that, there are handbills we can use. There are banners we can use. And then special retreat jingles to be used as ringtones on select telecom companies. Invitation and publicity must be done repeatedly until all the people here and all the places and all the places are covered and all are sufficiently convinced to attend the program. We're going to do everything, and this coming retreat is going to be totally different. Number three now, participation and prayer for the promised blessing. Participation and prayer for the promised blessing. I want to tell you, there are two things there. It's not enough to just say, yes, I pick participation, but I will not pray. No, that's not enough. Okay, I'll preach prayer, but I will not participate. No, that's not enough. Must join both together. We see with the two eyes. We walk with the two legs, and we handle and carry things with our two hands. And those two things, those two branches, must be there. Number one, participation. Number two, prayer going on hand in hand. And let's see those things joined together. Psalm 122, Psalm 122. In Psalm 122, verse 1, I was glad when he said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. That's participation. I was glad when he said unto me, I accepted that, I received that, I said, I'll be part of it. Participation. But understand, participation alone is not enough. Join prayer with it. Look at this now in verse 6. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They shall prosper that love thee. Peace within thy walls and prosperity within thy palaces. For my brethren and companions' sakes, I will now say, peace be within thee, because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. That's prayer. We need peace in our country, peace in our community, peace in every local government, and peace in every section of every society. We need to pray that there will be peace, and then as we say, we're going to participate, and we're also praying together, God will make a way. It will be possible for everyone to attend. For us here, it's possible we're going to attend. And for them over there, anywhere they are in this country and outside this country, it will make possible by, because we're participating and we're also praying, and the Lord will see us through in Jesus' name. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 55, participation and prayer. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 5 and verse 6. Isaiah 55, verse 5. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee. You see, even people we have not known before, total strangers to us, we're going to tell them. And those who did not know us, and those we did not know, at this time will reach out to everyone. Will touch everyone and will bring everyone. And the word of God here says they will participate with us because of the Lord thy God and for the Holy One of Israel, for he has glorified thee. That's participation, not the prayer. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found, call ye upon him while he's near. While we're participating and we're publicizing and telling people and telling this and telling this, telling our friends that we know, and telling strangers that we don't know, and we're inviting them to come, and they're joining us and participating together with us, we're also seeking the Lord while he may be found, and calling upon him while he is near. Zechariah chapter 8, participation and prayer. We participate, we get involved, we publicize, we proclaim, we tell other people, we say, let us go, and we will go also. And then we pray along. In Zechariah chapter 8, reading from verse 21, an inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us go speedily. That's participation. Let us go. I'm going, you are going, we're going together. Let us go speedily to pray before the Lord. That's the prayer. You see, we must join both together. You cannot just neglect one, hopping on one leg and trying to carry a heavy load with only one hand, or trying to wash yourself with only one hand, or trying to tie your wrapper with only one hand, but both hands, or trying to go somewhere, both legs, or trying to look at something, seeing the vision with only one eye, but with both eyes to see. And so that's why those two things were joined together, participation and prayer. And it says, pray before the Lord and to seek the Lord of hosts. I will go also. Yea, many people and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem and to pray before the Lord. We will do it. And when we pray, God will answer. If you have never seen answered prayer, a miracle is coming your way. Jeremiah chapter 29, Jeremiah chapter 29, and we're reading from verse 11, Jeremiah 29, verse 11, for I know the thoughts that I think toward you. God is thinking about you. He's already writing some things down. He says, when you get there, this is what I'm going to do for you, this is what I'm going to do for you, you will not miss it. I said you will not miss it. I says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you what? An expected end. That expectation of your heart, of your life, of your family will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. It will answer your prayer. And ye shall seek me and shall find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. We're looking at Psalm 2, verse 8. Psalm 2, we're looking at verse 8. Psalm 2, verse 8. Ask of me. Will you ask? Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance. And the uttermost parts of the earth, for what? For thy possession. This time, we're not going to limit our prayer. We're going to pray extensively, and we're going to broaden our request, and the Lord is going to grant us our request that we're broadening, extended request, the Lord is going to give us in Jesus' name. in Isaiah chapter 60. Isaiah chapter 60. From verse 3. From verse 1. Arise and shine. I said, arise and shine. For thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. A new time is coming. A great thing is coming. A great breakthrough is coming for you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, gross darkness, the people, but the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings shall to the brightness of thy rising. Lift up your eyes round about and see. All day gather themselves together. They come to thee. They are coming to this retreat. It's going to be a great feast of the Lord. They come to thee. Thy sons shall come from far. Those who have lost any child, thy sons shall come from far. And those who have not seen for a long time, husband gone away, wife gone away, this is going to be the time of a great reunion. And members backsliding who have gone away, it's going to be a time of great reunion. You'll see people you have not seen for years. And great will be your joy and delight in the Lord in Jesus' name. And then it says, and thy daughters shall be nursed at thy side. Verse 5, then thou shalt see and flow together, and thine heart shall fear and be enlarged, because the abundance of the sea shall be converted unto thee. And the forces of the Gentiles shall come unto thee. Those are the blessings the Lord says is going to shower upon his people in this retreat. In verse 14, thy sons also, the sons also of them that afflicted thee shall come bending, bowing, kneeling before you. And all they that despise thee shall bow and bend and kneel and prostrate themselves down at the soles of thy feet. And they shall call thee the city of the Lord, the Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Whereas thou hast been forsaken and hated, so that no man went through thee, I will make thee an eternal excellency, a joy of many generations. Thou shalt also suck the milk of the Gentiles, shall suck the breast of kings, and thou shalt know that I, the Lord, am the Savior, the Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. For brass, I will bring gold. For iron, I'll bring silver. And for wood, brass. And for stone, iron. And I will also make thy officers peace, and thy exactors righteousness. Violence shall no more be heard in thy land, wasting nor destruction within thy borders. But thou shalt call thy walls salvation, and thy gates praise. The sun shall no more, shall be no more thy light by day. Neither for brightness shall the moon give light unto thee, but the Lord shall be unto thee an everlasting light. And thy God, thy glory, the sun, thy sun, shall no more go down. Neither shall thy moon withdraw itself, for the Lord shall be thine everlasting light. The days of thy mournings shall be ended. Days of sorrows gone. This retreat is going to be a wonderful time. Thy people shall all be righteous. They shall inherit the land forever. The branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, the Lord, will hasten it in this time. The time has come. Are you ready? Why are you sitting now if you are ready? Why don't you tell the Lord something great is coming on the way? You will be there. I will be there. And tell everybody around. Tell everybody around something great is going to take place. And the Lord is saying that all these blessings, when you get back home, read that Isaiah chapter 60 again. And then mark them and think about them and meditate upon them. Something great is coming your way. Great will be your blessing. Great will be your blessing. My brother, my sister, tears will be wiped away. Sorrows will go. Sicknesses will go. Affliction will depart. Enemies will bow down before you. This retreat is going to be a time of joy, a time of celebration, a time of the outpouring of the blessing of God. My brother, get ready. My brother, prepare. My sister, get ready. My sister, prepare. Prepare with prayer and prepare your heart and prepare your mind and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you. You've been thinking about me. You're going to be there. I'm going to be there. We're going to be there together. What a great, great gathering that will be. And what a great outpouring that will be. The Lord is expecting you will be there. Something great is waiting for you, waiting for me, waiting for all of us. We'll be there together. You'll publicize it. You'll proclaim it. You'll tell everybody around. You will spread abroad the matter. Blaze abroad the matter. You get your publicity garment. Tell people within your state, within your region, and beyond your state, beyond your region. We have a retreat location in many places in this country, and many places in every region, many places in all the states. Let's tell them, let's tell them. This great harvest of blessing, riches of glory coming upon us. Tell them everywhere, tell them everywhere. Touch another life. Tell somebody, get excited about it, be zealous about it. You will do it. I will do it. We will do it together. Our time has come. Our time has come. A time of restoration. Our time of recovery. Our time of getting all the blessings we have lost. Everything coming back. Your family will overflow with blessing. Your spiritual life will be refreshed with blessing. And your professional life, everything will come alive once again. Something great, something good, something gracious, something wonderful coming upon everyone at this retreat. Make up your mind. You'll be there, I'll be there, we'll be there. The blessings we cannot receive when we're all alone by ourselves, but when we gather together, congregate together in this great, great gathering of the retreat. See what God will do. God said, come and put me to test and prove me. If I will not open you the windows of heaven and shower you blessings, you'll not be able to contain. The Lord has promised to bless us. He is ready. Why would we drag our feet? Why would we draw back? When the Lord has promised us that he's going to do something great and something wonderful for us. Get excited, because the Lord is going to do something great and something wonderful. Tell the Lord, tell the Lord. Get involved, get involved. Touch the life of another person. Reach out to another person. Your neighbor, your relative, your co-workers in the office, your co-tenants, professional people, the mechanic, the carpenter, everyone all around, within your vicinity where you live and beyond the place where you live. Just text them, talk to them, publicize it, touch their lives. Remember them now one by name. Yes, I'm going to reach Mr. So-and-so. I'm going to reach Miss So-and-so. I'm going to reach that child, my student in the school. I'm going to reach that teacher, my teacher in the school. Reach everyone. My friends, my colleagues, my co-tenants, my co-workers. I'm going to reach everyone. Commit yourself. Commit yourself. And let's gather together with a great, great number of the people that are discerning the blessings of the Lord. Tell them what you will get. Tell them what to expect. Tell them the great, great blessings. The Lord has reserved and preserved for everyone that will come. And make up your mind, you yourself, you will be there. You'll not be left out. You will not isolate yourself. Because in the gathering of the people of God, that is where the Lord will pour out all the riches of His glory. Showers of blessing. Showers of miracles. Showers of deliverances. What the Lord wants to give unto His people. Make a covenant with the Lord. The first covenant, I will go also. The first covenant, the first vow, I will go also. Nothing will hinder me. You push every other thing aside. You rearrange your time. That period, December 24th to 27th, you're not going to allow visitors to tie you down at home. You're not going to give appointment to anyone. You arrange your calendar, your agenda, and you say, I must be there, and I must be there fully. I will go. I will go. I will go also. And then now, after you've made up your mind, you're telling other people, let us go. Let us go. Let us go. You're pinpointing them, identifying them, so and so. Let us go. So and so. Let us go. All the members of your family, everyone, your wife, your husband, your children, your parents, you plead with them earnestly. You plead with them convincingly. Let us, let us, let us go. Plead with them. Convince them. This is the place to be. By the grace of God and the wisdom of God, knock up all the excuses. And say, no, that cannot be. We must be there together. And all the members of the church, all the members of the church, all the members of the church, your fellow members, fellow disciples in the church, why don't you reach them first? Charity begins at home. Publicity begins at home. Proclamation begins at home. Ask your brother, ask your sister. I'm sure you're going. I'm sure you've arranged, reorganized everything, and I'm sure you are going. And after we're convinced and registered all the members of the church without exception, they were reaching out to those who are not part of us yet. Reaching out to them. That's what God said. I've gathered them together. Even the people that are outside. Get yourself committed to that. Let the weak say, I am strong. Let those who are shy say, I am bold. This is not the time for timidity or shyness. This is the time to convincingly, courageously tell other people, touch the lives of other people, and tell them one by one, your director, your manager, the porter, the people, your servants, your maids, or the people that are serving you, everyone, telling them, this is what to do at this time. Let us go. Let us go. And remember, while you're publicizing it, don't ever say anything negative. And there's nothing else to talk about at this and push all the other conversations aside apart. At home, talk about this retreat and be positive about it. We'll get this, we'll get this, we'll get this, we'll get that. Be positive about it. Talking to your friends, talking to your neighbors, talking to your co-tenants, talking to your landlord, talking to your director, talking to your subordinates, talking to everyone. This is the one single thing to talk about, the retreat. Spread it abroad. Blaze it abroad. Tell everyone that this is the glorious time, the great time we'll be waiting for. And great will be the blessings the Lord will pour upon you, upon the people, upon all of us together. Let's remember our children. Come, children, make up your mind, you'll be there. There's a time when God will pour his abundant blessings upon you. Youths, teenagers, secondary school students, campus students. What a glorious time. What a glorious time. Don't miss this time of breakthrough and this time of opportunity. Let's go together. Let's go together. We will go. We will go. We will go. Tell the Lord and fulfill that promise. Don't let any emergency, any unexpected event ever stop you from fulfilling this commitment that you are making unto the Lord. If we are arranging transportation in your zone, in your district, let all our invitees know about the arrangement. And you know about the arrangement too. You are there on time. And then we're all there together on time. And let our transport officers get excited and zealous, working as hard as we've ever done. Because this is a special, special, special time. In all the regions, in all the states, in all the nations, in all the countries, in Africa and beyond Africa, this is a thing to concentrate on at this very time. God counts it special. We count it special. And when God counts something special, you count it special. And then we unite our hands together with God. Then something special and spectacular happens unto us. Tell the Lord, I count it as special as you do. He's eager to give, and we are as eager to receive. Tell the Lord, yes, Lord, we'll proclaim it. We'll publicize it. We'll participate in it together, and we'll pray together. And as we do, our blessings will know no limits.